Hello everybody all over the world. Welcome to this webinar organized by Canon Medical System about the fetal heart. The title that was given to me today is It May Even Puzzle the Expert. What I want to do today is to present to you some difficult cases. I will guide you through the signs that led us to the diagnosis. So these subtle signs that you can use in your daily fetal clinic to screen for cardiac defects. The basic views to assess the fetal heart are all known to you. The four-chamber view here, the left ventricular outflow tracts, the right ventricular outflow tract with the three-vessel view, and the three-vessel trachea view, or also called the transverse arches view. These views are already described in literature, and I hope that everybody uses them in this way. The past decade, a lot of attention has been given to the three-vessel view and the three-vessel trachea view. And therefore, I decided today to have a little bit more attention for the four-chamber view, to revisit the four-chamber view, because in this basic view, we can see a lot of things that guide us to the diagnosis. The first tip I want to give you is when you assess the four-chamber view to follow the bloodstream, because you have to assess the four-chamber view because it contains so much details. You have to assess it very systematically. And if you follow the bloodstream, if you do it in that way, you won't forget the things that you have to assess. So first, we start where the blood enters the heart, the atria, the left atrium, the right atrium, globally shaped and have to be more or less equal in size. To really see if they are equal in size, you can also assess the width. The width has to be comparable, as you can see here. And no need of difficult turning of the probe has to be made to see them. You have to see them easily. And to reassure that you are in a good transverse plane through the fetal chest is to check if you really see the ribs. So if you are in a good transverse plane, this has to be easily visible. Then the next step in the left atrium is to see if the pulmonary veins are entering the left atria. And that you see here, a more or less banana-shaped figure. There, the pulmonary veins are entering the left atrium. Sometimes there is some variation in the entering of the pulmonary vein. Sometimes it's a little bit more located here. The next step at the atrial level is the crux, to see if the crux is present. And if you see the crux, assess the atrial septum as a whole. Here we see the atrial septum with the foramen ovale flap opening and closing, and the opening of the foramen ovale is around 1/3 to 50% of the total distance of the atrial septum. The next step, if we follow the bloodstream, is the AV valves. Here you see the tricuspid valve. Here you see the mitral valve. And these two valves differ from each other if you look closely. First, the attachment of the valve at the atrial septum is a little bit higher compared to the tricuspid valve. So the mitral valve is attached a little bit higher than the tricuspid valve. This distance of around 2 millimeters is called differential insertion. And that is best seen in an apical four-chamber view. Another difference at the level of these valves is the papillary muscles. The papillary muscles of the mitral valves are attached to the ventricular free wall, which is clearly seen in this picture. The tricuspid papillary muscles are attached, and you can see that here, at the ventricular septum and at the base of the heart, and not at the free wall. Then we go to the ventricles. Here you see the left ventricle, more or less triangular shaped, especially the lower part of the left ventricle, which is forming the apex. The right ventricle is a little bit more globally shaped and contains the moderator band, which you can see here. And to assess if these ventricles have an equal length, you should look here. Just below the AV valves, the width of the ventricles, and that is very important, the width of the ventricles should be similar. Now let's go to our first case. This is our first case. If we assess this four chamber view, as I did to you in the previous slide, you will see that we have a problem with the symmetry in this heart. The left atrium and the left ventricle do not have an equal width compared to the right side of the heart. So the left side of the heart is smaller. This is not the same as an hypoplastic left heart syndrome, because this will not become a left hypoplastic heart, because this ventricle has enough length. It reaches the apex. Let's examine this heart a little bit further. What we see here is a good entering of the pulmonary veins. The area behind the heart is normal, so the descending aorta is closely to the left atrium. I forgot that with the previous slide. Let's go to the outflow tracts, because the four chamber view gave us the first signal that we should be aware that maybe something is wrong in this heart. So now we go a little bit further to the outflow tracts. And then you see here the aorta with a good valve, but small. This is the size of the aortic valve. And we use our Sinoloop and we go towards the pulmonary valve. And you see here the pulmonary valve, which is, I would estimate, almost twice the size of the aortic valve. But the flow across the aortic valve is unobstructed, so I'm not worried about hypoplastic left heart syndrome. And here we see the transverse arches, in which also there is discrepancy in size. We go to the next slide. The same baby. The aortic arch has continuity, so it's not interrupted. But I have a little bit doubt if here at the level of the isthmus, there is some indentation. It's also called shelf, posterior shelf. Although it is very subtle, and it is not a signal that really assures a real diagnosis. Again, the transverse arches fuse, the baby turned around. And what you see here is that in diastole, there is a tiny bit of reversal of flow. So the combination of this sign should make us suspicious of a possible coarctation of the aorta. This is really, really a difficult diagnosis and carries extremely low detection rates in screening programs. But the other way around, when we see these signs, in a lot of cases, nothing is wrong after birth. But the diagnosis is a very severe condition, and therefore it is globally accepted that we admit these children to the ICU ward and follow them up when the duct closes. That is a more or less aggressive approach when we have such high false positive rates. But if you miss the diagnosis, the baby will go into cardiovascular collapse and becomes very sick. So what are the signs? And I want to stress that each individual sign is not diagnostic. But if you combine the size, the signs, the chance of a coarctation becomes high. So discrepancy in ventricles and the size of semilunar valves, discrepancy in the transverse arches fuse between the ductus and the isthmus, and the appearance of a posterior shelf and diastolic flow persistence. Again, each individual sign being present does not is not diagnostic, but the combination makes a coarctation very high risk for that. Next case. Again, a case with left-sided discrepancy. So the width of the left ventricle is smaller compared to the right ventricle, but with a good sufficient length of the left ventricle. And here with flow, very nice color Doppler flow. The pulmonary veins entering the left atrium at this level. And here, a good filling of the left ventricle and unobstructed outflow. But here, a second explanation for the discrepancy in size is present. And that you can see here in the B-mode image. If you have a careful look, you see that the flap of the foramen ovale is almost reaching the free atrial wall. You can see that here. And with the color Doppler, you can see that the flow, the bloodstream, is circling within this aneurysmatic flap of the foramen ovale, and it's not shunting towards the left atrium. So it's restricted. It's flowing here and not across the flap. Here is the still image of this movie clip showing the pulmonary venous return. And this plane is taken closely towards the diaphragm, so behind that bulging foramen ovale. And then you see here that the left ventricle is filled only by the pulmonary venous return behind that bulging aneurysmatic foramen ovale flap. And here we go a little bit higher in the four chamber view, and here even in the outflow tracks. And I will play the full clip for you. Outflow tracks unobstructed, and here delayed slowly. The left ventricle only filled by pulmonary venous return. This is a situation which is benign. After birth, the foramen ovale closes and there is no further risk for this baby. Here again, the aortic arch and good transverse arches. So a case of diminished flow across the foramen ovale, or maybe we can call it restricted because of an aneurysmatic foramen ovale flap, which is defined as a bulging valve flap, which bulges into the left atrium for more than 50% of this distance. It's not so rare. It carries a prevalence. The reports in literature differ a lot, but between 1 and 5%. It is associated with coarctation, so it is wise to follow up these children. And also premature atrial contractions and how that develops, it is unknown, but we think that it is irritating the atria, and therefore premature atrial contractions may develop. So follow-up is needed, but first of all, I think there is room to reassure the parents, because this is really, in most cases, a very benign finding. So we continue to our next case. And again, a case with left-right discrepancy. A small left ventricle and a wider right ventricle. Again, compare at this level and then you see it. But also at the level of the atria, a wider right atrium and a smaller left atrium. What I want to point out, and that I forgot in that first slide, is that it is important to look at the distance between the left atrial border and the descending aorta. This is the same case. You see that the difference here is quite wide. This should be very close to each other, and that is already the sign towards the diagnosis in this case. And here again, and what is also missing is that banana-shaped black figure of the entering of the pulmonary veins in the left atrium. This left atrium is more or less flattened, and it does not contain those black spots where the pulmonary veins are entering. But if you put on your color Doppler, and please be aware that the PRF should be turned low to detect low flow velocities, we see a blue signal here. And that is resembling the entering of the pulmonary veins in the left atrium. But please, in this dual image, compare it again, this image to the image here in your B mode. And here, I am not convinced that that blue signal is really entering that left atrium. Go to the next slide. A little bit tilting and rotating of the probe. And then we are getting more convinced about our diagnosis. That blue signal is not entering the left atrium, but passing by the left atrium, and that you see here and here. The flow velocity waveforms in this vessel were showing a normal signal of a normal pulmonary vein. So I'm still wondering where that vein is going to, and that we will see in the next slide. Here again, smooth turning and movements of the probe, and here you see it. And again, look at the same time in your B image and use your CineLoop. And your CineLoop is here on your computer, just by moving my mouse. And here you see it very nicely in the B mode image, the superior vena cava. Caval vein, the superior caval vein, visualized here. And here the blue signal, and that is not called a pulmonary vein, but now it's called collector vein entering the vena cava superior. And I will play it again one time for you. Here the collecting vein entering the superior caval vein. So a case of totally abnormal pulmonary venous return with a good unobstructed collector vein. Next case, a little bit older case, 32 weeks. Here again, the search for the diagnosis starts off with an asymmetrical four-chamber view, the width of both atria and ventricles are not equal, with right ventricular dominance and a smaller left ventricle, but with sufficient length of the left ventricle. Also here, an aneurysmatic foramen ovale valve. And also here, an increased distance between the wall of the left atrium and the descending aorta. And have a look at the lung. Here you see that the tissue of the lung is not appearing normal, with all tiny black holes in the tissue. We go to the next slide. Here we were looking, searching for the pulmonary venous return, and the only thing what we could find was this. This was an artery, red towards the probe, and the blue one was this vessel with this signal, a venous signal, but very, very abnormal. And whatever we did, it ended here, blindly. A similar case, another baby. Again, beginning off with left-right discrepancy. And here that abnormal appearance of the left atrium was even more extreme. Although we did our utmost best, we could not visualize a good global left atrium with the banana shape of the pulmonary veins entering the left atrium. Again, also an extreme large distance of the descending aorta between the descending aorta and the left atrium. And again, also here, a rim of fluid. And I will show it in the next slide. Again, that abnormal appearance of the tissue of the lung. And we call that nutmeg appearance of the lung. Again, this is not hypoplastic left heart. This is discrepancy in size with sufficient length of the left ventricle. When we were searching for the pulmonary veins, first we thought, is this a pulmonary vein? Because it is almost exactly at the spot where the pulmonary veins should be. But again, be aware, this is an atrial signal. It is red in most of the times, and if you put your pulse wave gate in it, you will find an arterial signal. And the pulmonary venous signals could not be visualized anywhere in this baby. So, three cases of totally abnormal pulmonary venous return. The signals that guide you to this diagnosis is left-right discrepancy, with a small flattened left atrium, an increased distance of between the left atrium and the descending aorta. And what is very handy is to use color Doppler, which is also essential not to misjudge arterial, the pulmonary arteries for pulmonary veins. And of course, the settings of your machine should be optimal for pulmonary veins with low PRFs. The last two cases were very special cases, and that were cases with obstructed collectors or almost absent collector veins. And in these cases, which carry a very, very poor prognosis, we saw a rim of fluid, a nutmeg appearance of the lung, and very abnormal flow velocity waveforms. And these signs are known in literature as being associated with obstructed collectors. So what you should do is look for the collector vein and see if you can follow that collector vein into the superior vena cava or the inferior vena cava or the coronary sinus, and that will be enlarged in those cases, or in this way to the superior vena cava as well. Then I will finish with the last case. Now we go to very early pregnancy, to the first trimester. This is a 12-week-old fetus with an increased nuchal translucency and also some high drops. And here, as well as in the other cases, there is discrepancy in size. But in these tiny 12-week fetuses, then the left ventricle is no longer visible anymore. So we see a right atrium, a right ventricle, and the left ventricle cannot be seen. What is very helpful in these cases is to put on, for instance, SMI. Then you can see the flow, and what you can see here, that there is still a little bit of flow. I will guide you through this clip. There is a tiny little bit of flow in the left ventricle, but it does not reach the apex. So you should be very aware of a developing left hypoplastic heart syndrome. Here you can see that nicely. Here is the flow in the left ventricle, and the right ventricle is longer. I will play this clip again for you. And here you see the pulmonary arteries even. And to compare it with a normal case, this is a normal case of a comparable gestational age. And you see that I did not take superb imaging quality of this patient, because this patient was quite large, but still, with the use of these kind of techniques, you can nicely see a good equal filling for chamber view of this tiny fetus. So the take-home message for today is to assess all details in your plane. Don't consider the four chamber view as just four black holes, but really assess all the details that I've shown to you. And if you are in doubt, please refer for an expert examination. I thank you very much for your attention. And if there are questions, please do not hesitate to send me an email. Thank you very much.